will be trouble.
Of course, machines can't think as people do. A machine is different.
You were early for the 3D film, so I'm going to fill in the gap. I'm very grateful for the introduction, Melanie, and for the invitation. Melanie wanted me to say a few words about the science, correct or not, behind The Martian, the movie. And so I'm going to essentially give you an overview of our current thinking for sending humans to Mars. The presentation I'm going to give you follows the outline of an upcoming book that I'm working on. And it's so it will discuss the what, why, how, when, and who of a human mission to Mars. So without further ado, let me go into this. I will just say one thing. I know Andy Weir quite well, of course, the author of the book, The Martian. Andy's a super smart guy, and he did an amazing job with his book. If you haven't read the book, you really should. It's a real thriller. Andy was aware of some technical inaccuracies in his book even before it was published. He wanted to correct them, but the publisher actually told him not to touch the book, the manuscript as it stood. They did not want the story to be altered. That much they liked it. So Andy just left it, and now, of course, he's regretting. He has, author's remorse, I guess. But nevertheless, in spite of a few things that, people working at NASA will like to pick on, it has been a fantastic stimulation for this idea of getting humans to Mars. And I'm very grateful to Andy for having put together this book. And the movie has its amazing qualities as well, so I'm looking forward to watching it with you. So what is a human mission to Mars? Well, here we are on the Earth. This is showing you the main part of the solar system with the planets to scale, not in terms of their distances, but in terms of their sizes. Okay, so the Earth and its little moon are shown there. And so we have been to the moon. Nobody has been to Mars yet or to Venus. The moon is as far as we've traveled. And only 12 human beings have walked on the moon. They were all Americans. And so our next step in space, if you will, is to go to Venus or Mars. Now, Venus is a very unpleasant place. It's more similar to the Earth in terms of its size and therefore its gravity, okay? But the temperatures at the surface are 495 degrees C. That's essentially the inside of a pizza oven. The atmospheric pressure is super high, okay? So you'd be crushed by the 90 bars of the atmospheric pressure of Venus. And so all you could cook in that pizza oven is a thin crust pizza, okay? Nothing would rise against that pressure. And also it rains sulfuric acid on Venus, okay? So it's pretty much the definition of hell. And so therefore, our sights are set on Mars, which is literally and figuratively a cool planet, all right? Cooler than the Earth. It's a little bit farther than Venus is sometimes, but it's much more welcoming than Earth. And then everything beyond is for future generations to worry about in terms of getting humans there. So now you have the three main planetary bodies I'm going to talk about tonight, the Earth, where the mass of the Earth is so big that we have a gravity field that we call 1G, okay, as a sort of a standard. The Moon is quite a bit smaller than the Earth. Gravity on the Moon is 6 times less than on the Earth, okay? So let's say you weigh 100 pounds, okay? Consider yourself lucky. But if you went to the moon, you would feel that you weigh only 6 times less, so 17% of your weight on the Earth. You would feel that you weigh 17 pounds. So that's why you can hop around, quite nicely. If you went to Mars, you can already guess it's intermediate in size and mass between the Earth and the moon. So gravity on Mars is 0.38 g. If you weigh 100 pounds on Earth, you would feel that you weigh only 38 pounds on Mars. You can jump on Mars 2.6 times higher than on Earth. If you play basketball, and obviously you don't since you're here tonight, you would set the hoop of the basketball 2.6 times higher than you would on the Earth to keep the game fair. Okay. So let's say you're planning this trip to Mars. Here are the good things and the bad things about this place in terms of a human visitor. The good things are that, well, it's got a day that lasts 24 hours and 37 minutes. It's a pure coincidence. Could have been much longer, could have been much shorter. It turns out to be 24 hours and 37 minutes. I don't know about you, but I personally could use an extra 37 minutes each day to get things done. And it also has water in abundance. There's water in the poles, there's water in the ground in the form of ice, there's water locked up in minerals in the form of clays, there's water in locked up and trapped in salts. Okay? So there's plenty of water, and anywhere we go, there would be a way to extract some water from the surface materials or even the atmosphere. The bad news is this. I've listed for you on the right there the five key things that will kill you on Mars in chronological order of cause of death. So from top to bottom, if you were exposed to the Martian surface environment without the protection of a spacesuit, the first thing that would kill you is a low atmospheric pressure. That would kill you in seconds. All the gases that are dissolved in your blood right now, the nitrogen, the oxygen, would bubble up if you were exposed to the Martian atmospheric pressure. And so you would fizz to death. It would be like popping a can of Coke. The gases dissolved in the Coke, the CO2 would essentially bubble up, and you would die a cruel and unusual death. Okay. Now, that would take seconds. Let's say you somehow survive that. Then the atmosphere is unbreathable. It's made of CO2, not oxygen, so there's very little oxygen there's nothing that's not enough oxygen, free oxygen for you to breathe. So CO2 is toxic for you. You would asphyxiate from just breathing Martian air. Then that would kill you in a matter of minutes. Then the frigid temperatures. The frigid temperatures on average, the temperature on Mars is minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit on average. Okay, so that will kill you in a matter of hours. And then the dust, this pervasive dust that's all over the planet, that gives the planet its reddish color as well. This dust is bad news for three reasons. One, it's very fine grained, so it's going to lodge itself in the pores of your lungs. It's going to clog the pores of your lungs. You'll experience what's known as miner's disease. Miners exposed to coal mines essentially lose their breathing capacity over time because the tiny particles of coal are essentially clogging the pores of their lungs. Okay, that's called silicosis. Also, the dust is very abrasive, so it's made of little shard-like particles, mostly crushed volcanic rocks. This abrasiveness will tear up the lung tissue, and you will start having internal bleeding of your lung tissue. And then thirdly, the dust itself is chemically toxic for you. It's replete with peroxides, perchlorates. You may not be familiar with perchlorates, but peroxides you are. Hydrogen peroxide, okay, that's in the liquid form. You imagine that in sort of solid state, you're ingesting that. So at first you'll have a warm, fuzzy feeling in your lungs, and then eventually it will burn. Okay, so you would essentially choke to death. In a matter of weeks, you are basically dead on Mars breathing dust. And incidentally, in the movie The Martian, right there you have a couple of things that are not very well depicted. Number one, the atmospheric pressure is so low, okay, that even though the wind speeds on Mars can be very high, okay, you will never really feel a strong wind pressure. In other words, the wind is unable on Mars, no matter how fast it's blowing at you, to push over a satellite dish or yourself. It'd be like standing in the stratosphere of the Earth looking at the jet stream. It's coming at you at maybe 200 miles an hour, but you would hardly feel a breeze. Okay, so it will loft dust, it will fly dust past you, but you would not really feel any dynamic pressure. And the thing about the dust as well, so separate from the pressure, the dust is also problematic in the film because the astronaut at some point, I don't want to reveal too much, but brings in dirt from the outside environment of Mars into the cabin where he lives to grow potatoes. Well, unfortunately, the soil of Mars is replete with these peroxides and perchlorates are toxic. They will affect your thyroid. So if you are growing potatoes in perchlorate-rich soil, you will have perchlorate-contaminated potatoes. Okay, and No amount of pooping into the perchlorate soil will render the potatoes edible. Okay, so it is just not a good idea to bring dust into the cabin. But we'll see in a second that you don't actually have to do that to grow potatoes. And then finally, if none of this has killed you, well then radiation will take care of that, because on Earth here we are protected from space radiation, which is coming from deep space, but also from the sun, high energy particles, okay, that would cause cancer if you were exposed to it directly. We're protected by both the thick atmosphere on the Earth and also by the Earth's magnetic field. Okay. On the Earth, we're like on board Starship Enterprise. The shields are up, so we are protected. But if you were at the surface of Mars, you don't have much of an atmosphere protecting you, and also Mars does not have a magnetic field today. And so you would be exposed to the brunt of space radiation, and so would essentially develop cancer over a matter of months. Okay, so anyway, there you have it. A very, very unpleasant place. You would wonder why are we even wanting to go there. I'm showing you here ways to grow potatoes without using soil. That's actually a very well-known technique. Mark Watney might be the best botanist on Mars, but apparently not the best one on Earth. You don't need to bring in soil to grow potatoes, you just need nutrients and water. On the left, we're growing plants in a little greenhouse in the Arctic without the use of soil, just hydroponics. And so nutrients and a bit of water in little buckets. And then on the right, you can even grow potatoes without soil or a solid substrate. These are aeroponically grown potatoes, so they're just hanging from nets. And you're just dribbling a bit of nutrient-rich fluid onto these potatoes. It's perfect in countries like Vietnam, where the soil is not necessarily good for growing potatoes, but where it's wet enough to have enough moisture to grow potatoes. Okay. All right, how far is Mars? Well, this is the Earth and the Moon to scale at the top. If the Earth is that size, that's how far and how small the Moon actually is. This surprises a lot of people sometimes. We get the impression that the Moon is bigger and closer. It's actually pretty far away. So for the Apollo astronauts who in the late 1960s and early 70s flew to the Moon, it was just an incredible journey. Ever since Apollo, since December of 1972, all of human spaceflight with the Soviet Union, Russia, or the United States and China, all of human spaceflight has taken place within one pixel, one picture element of that image of the Earth on the left. Okay, so we've all been in low Earth orbit, the space station, the space shuttle, Salyut, Mir, all of that is really in our immediate neighborhood. Going to the Moon was an incredible journey. And I'm not surprised that 40 or 50 years later, some people are still wondering if that was really, if it really happened. But it did, of course. So at the bottom, so by the way, to go to the Moon, if you have the right rocket, like a Saturn V, which is what the Apollo astronauts use, you can get to the Moon in 3 days. You can spend as long as you want at the Moon and then come back in about 3 days. So you could leave Monday morning for the Moon. Okay, and you're back Sunday night, basically, and then back to work Monday morning. All right. Mars is a different story. At the bottom here, I'm showing you the Earth going around the Sun. That takes 365.25 days. And then Mars is traveling on a wider orbit, farther from the Sun than the Earth. And it's also traveling slower. Not only does it have more ground to cover, but it's actually traveling slower. So the Earth is, every now and then, passing Mars. It happens once every 26 months. And right now, we have just passed Mars a few days ago, so you can still see Mars as a very bright red star in the night sky. It's because we're just there where our distance to Mars is at its shortest, and that's about 140 times the distance from the Earth to the Moon. But when the Earth is on the other side of the Sun from Mars, okay, then the distance is 1,000 times the Earth-Moon distance. Okay? So going to Mars is not just the next step, it's really a big giant leap. It's going to take time. So if you travel to Mars, here's a typical scenario. You leave the Earth, 6 months to get to Mars. Once you get there, you could come back immediately, but it's very expensive fuel-wise. You may not be carrying enough. And so what you want to do is wait for the Earth and Mars to reposition themselves so that you can travel back affordably. And that means waiting on Mars or at Mars for 18 months. And then you can fly back to the Earth cheaply, and that's another 6 months trip to come back. So all in all, you're spending a year in deep space, outbound 6 months, inbound 6 months, okay? And then the rest of the time, a year and a half at or on Mars. So in total, you're gone from the Earth 30 months. That's 900 days. That's 2.5 years. It's long, but not much longer than ancient sailing expeditions around the Earth. I mean, people have gone on voyages that long. People have stayed in prison for much longer. Okay. So where do we stand in terms of our experience in space in relation to such durations? Well, the longest single space flight to date was by this medical doctor, Valery Polyakov, from the Soviet Union at the time. He spent in one space flight 437 days and 18 hours. That's 1.2 years in space. That remains the record to beat. The most time spent in space by this astronaut, Gennady Padalka, his record was established just June of last year. Over the course of 5 missions, he's totaled now 2.4 years of his life spent in space. Okay, so we're getting up to the numbers that are commensurate with a mission to Mars. And then recently, the US established its longest space flight on a single flight. That's by Scott Kelly. He spent 0.9 years on board the International Space Station. So why would we go to Mars? Well, this is my personal favorite reason, but I'll show you shortly that there are many more. What you have here on the left is known as the tree of life on Earth. All living forms of life on Earth plot onto this tree in that they all possess DNA. And how close you are to another branch of this tree is a reflection of how much in common you share in your DNA with that other form of life. Okay? So human beings share a lot with zoa, which are the large animals that surround us. We're different DNA-wise, but we share a lot with them. And there is a part of our DNA that's substantially in common. But we share in common DNA with all these other forms of life. The eukarya are the life forms that are relatively complex, that have nuclei in their cells and are multicellular. The archaea and the bacteria are unicellular organisms. They are microbial, all of them. The archaea tend to be narrowly adapted to specific environments. The bacteria tend to be more widely adapted, like E. coli that you see up there on the bacteria. E. coli is in your stomach, but it's also all around you. Now, we share DNA in common even with E. coli, okay? Not a lot, not as much as with, you know, my dog or squirrels, but we do. Now, what's interesting is that no form of life on Earth does not plot onto this tree. Everybody's on this tree, okay? And what we think that the commonality in that DNA trunk tells us is that there was a common ancestor to all life on Earth, and somehow we are the result of diversification over time from this original form of life. And this original form of life, we have no record of it anymore. It would be so old that it would be in rocks that have all been mangled, processed by plate tectonics and the evolution of the Earth. We no longer have any example of what we would call the original form of life on Earth, nor do we know actually that it exists, but it's the hypothesis behind the interpretation of this tree. When you go to Mars and you say you're looking for life on Mars, what you're really wanting to find is an alien form of life. Okay? It's a form of life that would not plot onto our tree of life. That would be an amazing thing. So either it does not use DNA, or it uses a different form of DNA, okay? Maybe different bases or acid bases in its composition. So it's very possible that you could find life on Mars, but it's just Earth life that got exported to Mars. We know that we have meteorites, for example, that have come naturally from Mars. Mars gets hit every now and then by asteroids and comets. They kick off Mars rocks into space. Some of these rocks run into the Earth. We collect them as meteorites from Mars. We have in our collections today about 100 meteorites that we know 100% have come from Mars. Okay? And that's a whole discussion as to how we know, but we're certain that they come from Mars. And that is telling you that planets are not isolated. Life could have started on Mars, seeded the Earth. We could all be descendants of Martian life, all we know. That's a theory that's out there. I don't think it's likely, but it's out there. It's published, and you know, people make it part of the trade space. But similarly, you could find life on Mars, and it's just exported Earth life. we could be finding maybe a derivative of bacterial archaea on Mars. And if that were the case, we couldn't conclude that life is somehow a universal phenomenon and that we should expect to find life in other, on other planets elsewhere. Because it would just be one form of life, you know, exported to another planet. But if we found an alien form of life, now you've got a big story, okay? Because now, on two planets in one solar system, you would have two separate trees of life. With two trees, you have the beginnings of a forest of life out there. That's my favorite reason to go to Mars, the science, the search for life. I have a laundry list here of reasons, reasonable reasons that I've collected over the years for reason to go to Mars. I offer a dollar to every person in the audience who gives me a reasonable reason that somehow is not already captured in this list. Not too long ago, I was in Australia and I gave this talk and a hand came up in the audience and that resulted in the last line there. Establish a new colony of prisoners and convicts. As you know, that's how Australia was founded, okay? So I tried to wiggle my way out of having to pay a dollar by saying, well, isn't that captured in store waste there somewhere? That didn't go too well. So I had to pay a dollar, but it was just an Australian dollar. Okay, but the thing is, for all these good reasons that are there, including become a multi-planet species, which is why Elon Musk wants to go to Mars, a whole bunch of other ones that I think are compelling. The bottom line is that no society historically has spent big bucks exploring unless it served the national interest. And that is something that really has to be understood. Lewis and Clark were not sent out west by President Jefferson because he was interested in science. This was sent out west because it was imperative for the young United States to know who was living out there, what the trading routes were, how to communicate with these people, and how do we trade with them. Similarly, President Kennedy did not send Americans to the moon in the mid-60s because we somehow were interested in lunar science and moon rocks, okay, in the mid-60s. It was because the Soviet Union was a threat. We had to do something big enough, difficult enough in space to beat the Soviet Union at something in space. They were ahead of us at the time. And that, Mr. President, is to put a man on the moon and bring him back safely by the end of the decade. So this is why we invested big bucks into going to the moon. It had nothing to do with science. Of course, once you go to the moon, what are you going to do? You're not going to open a law firm or a bank branch. You're going to pick up rocks, do geology. So science dominates the activity you conduct, but it has nothing to do with the motivation of your presence. This is really important to understand. And so similarly today, the NSF, for example, spends about $2 billion a year maintaining research stations in Antarctica. We are doing that because it's of strategic national interest for us to be in Antarctica. There are other countries there. There are resources in Antarctica down the road to be harvested. We need to be there. And of course, once you've committed to being there, you do science because there's nothing else to do in Antarctica for now. Okay? But science is not, no matter how good the science is, it's not the reason why we're there. All right? So why would we go to Mars? Well, Congress and no president since Kennedy has been convinced that it was in our strategic natural interest to send humans to Mars, to spend the several hundred billion dollars that it would cost to get Americans to Mars. Not quite yet. I would contend that it's a bit short-sighted. This is the only plot I'm going to show you, and we'll go through this quick. At the bottom x-axis here, you see the years of last century, from 1920 to 1999. Up here on the x, on the y-axis, you have the number of graduate degrees awarded by American universities, masters, PhDs, okay? And we're following four fields of science: physics, engineering, math slash computer sciences, and earth sciences. So all four plots go up towards the right. That's easy to explain. It's population growth in the US. Over time, the more people there are in the country, the more people go to school, the more degrees are awarded. So that's easy to explain. But what's remarkable is that hump that you see in physics and engineering, but also in math and computer sciences, okay, in the late 60s, early 70s. That's the Apollo program effect. Okay? An entire generation of young people were enthralled by this adventure, this journey into space and to the moon. and they got into science and technology. And this has become the foundation of our current society in terms of our cutting edge technology and what's keeping us a major leader among the nations of the planet. Okay, it's this incredible investment we did in the sciences and in technology. And a lot of it stems from the stimulation that the Apollo program provided. Jeff Bezos, who runs Amazon, okay, will tell you that he's totally inspired by Apollo. He has his own space company. Elon Musk is a bit younger than the generation of the 60s, but he was inspired by Apollo. That's what got him into science. So there are even late Apollo effects, like Elon Musk. Okay, these are people who were all engaged in technology and inspired by space travel, right? So this is the real benefit of an ambitious, even expensive space program. It's not the rocks that you bring back, okay? It's the new generation of techies that you train because they become the way for you to remain at the cutting edge of the economy, of the world's economy. We recently saw China land a little rover on the moon, and we poo-pooed that because we did that 50 years ago, or a robot. Within the next 10 years, China will land a human being on the moon, a Chinese astronaut. And we might poo-poo that because we've done that 50 years ago. But we're missing the main point. The main point is not the fact that China has the hardware to get people to the moon. A lot of countries do right now. The point that we're missing is that right now, as we speak, there's an entire generation of young people in China who are enthralled by their Chinese moon program, who are going into science, technology, engineering, and math. And this is going to be, if we don't collaborate with them, this is going to be the competition of the next generation. Okay. So how are we going to go to Mars? Well, it's far away. You got to pack a lot of things. You could be gone for a while. You can't go alone, so you need a big rocket. We took the Saturn V, which is standing right next to the space shuttle there, to go to the moon. We just need one of those. For one trip to Mars, we need six of the very giant rocket at the far right and one of the lesser giant to its left. This giant rocket is called the Space Launch System, SLS. It's being built as we speak in Huntsville, Alabama. Its first launch is slated for 2018. You've nothing better to do. I recommend we all go together on a field trip to Cape Canaveral, okay, Kennedy Space Center, and watch the launch of this most powerful rocket ever to fly. If it succeeds, it's going to be spectacular. If it doesn't, it's going to be spectacular. Okay, so how does this work in terms of a scenario? You need seven rockets in total, six of the small. This is from my children's book, Mission Mars, which you are free to order on Amazon. It costs the price of a burger. Six rockets, six giant rockets plus a smaller one. How does this work? Well, you first launch four rockets. This is actually according to a generic NASA scenario, so it's sort of quite basic. These first four rockets put together two spaceships. They are unmanned, nobody on board, and you send these two ships to Mars 2 to 4 years ahead of time, and they are carrying cargo. And they're carrying the stuff that you don't need to travel with, but that you want to make sure arrives on Mars in good shape. For example, the house you're going to live in on Mars, or the rovers that you're going to drive once you get to Mars. All that stuff, you don't want to travel with it. What if once you get to Mars, it doesn't make a good landing, and now you're missing a rover, or you don't even have a habitat? So you want to land all that stuff ahead of time. You know it's at the right place, in working order, waiting for you, and that's how you want to do it. So you send the stuff ahead of time. Once you know that it has arrived and it's in good shape, then you send two more giant rockets and they put together your spaceship, shown in big here. Your spaceship has hydrogen fuel tanks, rocket engines, different sections, which I'll show you in a second. This inflatable portion near the front is an inflatable habitat. It's sort of the outcome of the technology that's being tested right now as we speak on the space station, okay? And the inflatable habitat, you should think of it as sort of a bouncy house for astronauts. We also call it the space marshmallow. And at the very front end, you have the Mars lander. That little conical pod is the only part of the spaceship that actually lands on Mars. The rest would stay in orbit around Mars, wait for you to come back from Mars, and then bring you back to the Earth. All right. Now, once this is put together, more or less robotically, then it's time for you and your six crewmates, so seven people, this is a scenario for seven people, you board that smaller rocket, you launch, you get inside your spaceship, you make sure every button works, and then there's a big red button for you to push when it's time to go to Mars, and you push it, and off you go. All right, so here's what the inside might look like. Of course, it's simplified, cartoonized, but I'll just point out one thing about the inflatable section. This is where you spend most of your time, and if you notice, the walls of the inflatable spacecraft, of the inflatable section, the walls are lined with these things that look like sandbags. Of course, they're not sandbags. They are bags containing food and water. Okay? And the reason why you want to surround yourself with food and water is because food and water both contain hydrogen. And hydrogen is a very good absorber of space radiation. So in the absence of a thick atmosphere and in the absence of a magnetic field, surrounding yourself with hydrogen is sort of one way to mitigate the negative effects of space radiation. So there's good news and bad news with that. The good news is, okay, you're thirsty, so you drink water from one of these pouches, then you go to the bathroom, then you can see a yellow piece of pipeline that goes from the toilet to the machinery in the service module. Your urine gets recycled, okay, and it comes back out as clean water for you or your crewmates to drink. You cannot take on a 2.5-year journey to Mars fresh water for a crew of seven people. That's way too much water. You can only take so much, and then you're going to plan on recycling the water. So a few weeks into your trip to Mars, you are drinking each other's recycled urine and sweat. That's the good news. The bad news is the food. And within that, as a bit of good news, you can have the food that you like. Like if you like sushi, you can take bags and bags of sushi. If you like Indian food, like I do, you take Indian food, and there you go. Now, you eat the food, then you have to go to the bathroom. At that point, it's no longer like the urine. Okay? We do not recycle poop. NASA is not even trying. It's extremely difficult to do. There's no research at NASA that does that. If you write a proposal to NASA to say you want to recycle human waste, you will not get funded. Okay? We know that it's very difficult to do, to turn poop into something edible. So what do? You can't open a window in deep space and throw it out into space. No window opens, but that's not even the reason. You shouldn't pollute space. That's also not the reason. What you should realize is that your solid waste is still full of hydrogen. That is radiation shielding that you're looking at. Okay? And so in a resource-poor environment like deep space, even human waste, human solid waste, is a resource. Okay? And you want to be very sparing of that. So what do with your feces? You collect them in a Ziploc bag. Okay? Emphasis on lock. And I might add, very carefully. And that bag of your personal poop goes back on the wall where you took, you know, your sushi, or in my case, my curry, okay? With very careful labeling, I might add, because you don't want to, over time, okay, get confused. So you leave the Earth surrounded by fresh food and fresh water, and by the time you come back from Mars, you have essentially 6 months' worth plus 6 months, a year's worth of each other's recycled urine and sweat to drink multiple times, and each other's year's worth of feces. All right. Now, you may think this is a joke. It really isn't. We don't do this on the space station because the space station is in low Earth orbit. It's above the Earth's atmosphere, so it's exposed to some radiation, but it still is inside the Earth's magnetic field, and so you're well protected from deep space radiation at the altitude of the space station. So there's no need to resort to things like, you know, putting your poop on the wall, etc. But on a deep space mission to Mars, you're going to want to do that. Anyway, the big day arrives. You get to Mars. All seven of you cram into the little cabin. You enter the Martian atmosphere. The parachutes deploy if you're lucky. You shed the heat shield. Eventually, the parachutes become not effective enough to really slow you down to the point of landing. So you jettison the parachutes. You drop like a rock for about half a mile. And then the rocket engines ignite, if you're lucky, and you come to a soft touchdown. At this point, you're crammed like sardines, the seven of you in this little pod. It's not the thing you're going to live in. It's just the thing that gets you to the surface of Mars. And hopefully, you've landed within walking distance of this, the house and the rovers that you sent to Mars 2 to 4 years ahead of time. Okay? If you've landed too far, but still within driving distance of the rover, you can remote control the rover. It can come pick you up. This is called the airport shuttle scenario. If you land way too far, like you're on the other side of the planet, well, then you're essentially toast. What you can do still is a spacewalk. It will be your first and last spacewalk on Mars until you run out of oxygen, and then you're done. Okay. So it's really important that we do precision landing on Mars. Now, I've glossed over how are we going to explore this terrain, which you can see is made of sand and rocks mostly. So NASA goes to and will take you to all these exciting places, these deserts around the Earth that are in one way or another similar to Mars. They are extreme environments. Australia is extremely red. The Atacama is extremely dry. The Sahara is extremely sandy. Antarctica and the Arctic are extremely cold. Hawaii is extremely pleasant. Okay, but I'm going to talk to you about Devon Island up there, which is right next to Greenland, because it's where we've been going for the past 20 years. So Devon Island is about the size of West Virginia. It's the largest uninhabited island on Earth. When you go there, you are the population of Devon Island. The terrain looks like this. There's no vegetation to speak of. There's ice in the ground. It's very much like Mars in terms of its looks and its basic geology. We have a permanent base set up there, which we operate during the summer mostly. And it's teaching us how we might one day operate a research station on Mars. We are learning to explore at this location, so we're doing science, but we're also learning about the strategies that we should employ, the ones that are most productive to explore Mars in the future. One issue that we've been tackling is the spacesuit. The spacesuit is very important, of course, for you to be an effective explorer. This is the state of the art in spacesuits. It weighs 300 pounds on Earth, okay? It's impossible for you to use, of course, on the Earth, but thankfully we don't need a spacesuit to walk around on Earth. You use it in low Earth orbit where you are in microgravity, so this spacesuit weighs essentially nothing when you're weightless on the space station or flying around with a spacecraft in low Earth orbit. It still has the inertia, if you will, or the bulk of a 300-pound suit, but not the weight. Now, if you took this suit to the moon, where gravity is 6 times less, 300 pounds divided by 6, 50 pounds, you would feel that you're carrying a 50-pound weight on your back, all right? That's acceptable, and this is why Apollo was possible. 50 pounds is sort of the felt weight of the spacesuit on the moon. If you took the same spacesuit to Mars, where gravity is quite a bit higher than on the moon, the felt weight of the suit would be 125 pounds. Okay, way too heavy for you to walk around. So we've been working on this challenge to reduce the mass of the spacesuit, and what we need to do is to cut it in half. It's a big challenge. So on Devon Island, we've been working with the spacesuit engineers at Hamilton Sundstrand to come up with the next generation spacesuit that will be light enough for us to go to Mars. In addition to being light, it has to withstand dust storms. We already know that when you when dust particles impinge the fabric of the spacesuit over time, they will create wear and tear and little craters in the fabric. That's not good. So we're working on new fabrics to withstand dust storms on Mars. We also know that we want to do things like rock climbing, so we need the suit to be very flexible. So ultimately, it might look like this. It's blue in color because that's the complementary color to orange. It's the most visible color on Mars. Thick boots, gaiters around your lower legs to make sure that your lower legs don't get punctured by sharp rocks. A smartphone on your wrist, you can use it as a checklist. The Apollo astronauts used to have an actual binder with rings and pages. You can use a little smartphone for that. You can also take selfies with it. This is a rear entry suit, so you enter it by opening the backpack. The backpack swings open like a refrigerator door. You climb in legs first, so your feet go all the way down to your boots. Then you insert the arms, and then you close the backpack behind you, and off you go. Okay, so Walking on Mars would be a challenge. The terrain is rocky, and above all, it's often sandy, and sandy is really bad news for walking on Mars. We've been trying that with Hamilton Sunstrand using their 60-pound spacesuit simulating the spacesuit on Mars. We've been using at Dumont Dunes, for example, in the Mojave Desert, hiking up and down sand dunes. You get exhausted really quickly. Okay, so we need the suit to be as light as possible. And in fact, walking will be something that you won't do very often. You'll try to do as little of it as possible. I mean, it's good exercise at some level, but you really need to be productive as well exploring. So we'll have rovers. On the moon, we had this little buggy. It was made by Boeing, not GM. It was electric, and it could carry two astronauts at a time. For Mars, we anticipate, since we're going to be there for much longer than we were on the moon, we anticipate that each astronaut will have his or her ATV. All right. And this is, I think, a good solution because the ATV will carry some of the mass that you can now offload from the backpack of your spacesuit. You don't need big batteries anymore. You don't need big oxygen tanks in your spacesuit. You just need small batteries, small oxygen tanks. And while you're driving this thing, you can recharge your backpack, and therefore you don't need large tanks. The second feature about this ATV that's important is that it's robotic. So if you step off of your ATV to go pick up a rock, you don't have to lug the rocks all the way back to your rover like they did on Apollo. The rover will follow you like a dog. You can talk to it, sort of think R2-D2. Okay, so that's how we envision exploring Mars with personal mobility systems. Now, for longer road trips, you want a pressurized rover. That's sort of the motorhome for Mars. Inside, you're in shirt sleeves, and you put on a spacesuit to go outside. Notice that this is from the movie The Martian. So this is no longer fundamentally flawed. This is more like suboptimal design, if you would say. Okay. Notice the cabin is very angular. That's actually not a very good shape for a pressure vessel. You want, you know, high atmospheric pressure on the inside of the cabin for you to live comfortably. And so you want something that's rounded. This is why airplanes are rounded. And NASA has been working on this concept pressurized rover for Mars. And you can see that it's got rounded fuselages and cabin shapes. So something like this, for example, is going to be more realistic than something very angular. Okay. It's actually easy to drive. I was lucky to be the first scientist pilot of this thing when we first tested it in Arizona a few years ago. If you're right-handed, you joystick it from the right. If you're left-handed, you joystick it from the left. This is where all these hours of video gaming pay off. To make it go forward, you just push forward. To go backwards, you pull. To turn on the spot on the dime, you just twist it. And to make a wider turn, you push and you slant it as well to the side. Anyway, it's easy to drive. So another aspect of the movie The Martian that was suboptimal is this notion that the door, when it opens, would essentially make you lose all the air in your cabin. Okay, that's very wasteful. Okay, oxygen is at a premium. You don't want to, every time you go out, create a vacuum in your entire habitat inside your rover. That's very wasteful. So there's a better way to do this, to go in and out of your rover. That's how we do it on this NASA rover. The spacesuits are left outside at all times, and you go in and out of the rover directly from the inside of the cabin through the backpack. Remember, you open the backpack door. Okay, it swings open. Now you don't lose the entire volume of oxygen that's filling your cabin every time you go off on a spacewalk. Okay. Also, you never want to bring in the spacesuit into where you live. Remember, it's going to be covered in dust. Dust is bad news for you. So the Mark Watney scenario earlier has you walk in and out of your cabin with your spacesuit covered in dust. That's not very good. This solution allows you to keep the spacesuit outside at all times, and you don't bring in the dust. So this is showing you astronaut Rex Walheim demonstrating how you can enter your spacesuit. So this is taken from the inside of the rover. He's squeezing his way into the spacesuit, legs first. Behind him is the backpack door, and then further behind is the rover door that seals the hatch once he's walked off. Okay. Now, you might say it's hard to do a pull-up, okay, every time you want to get in and out of the suit. But remember, you are in Martian gravity, and you still have your earthly muscles. So it's going to be quite easy to get in and out of a spacesuit that way. Another feature of the spacesuit, it can drive itself at night. So let's say you've explored a site during the day, you climb back inside, you cook dinner, you ride home, you go to bed, you draw the curtains, and then somebody at Mission Control or the rover on its own robotically drives you to the next spot. And the next morning, you're at the edge of a new canyon. It's another day of exploration. Okay, so it's a very efficient way of exploring. We are learning about all these strategies using Humvees on Devon Island. We first had this red one, but we were getting it stuck, just like the rovers on Mars were getting stuck in sand and in mud. And so we got a second Humvee to Devon Island, but this time, this one, we drove it there on sea ice in the winter along the Northwest Passage. In hindsight, it was probably a bad idea, but it was an epic expedition that took about 3 years to complete. And a film is about to come out on our expedition, the Northwest Passage Drive expedition, and it's called Passage to Mars. So we had an advanced screening of it just 2 weeks ago in LA, and I'm told that it should be out in a theater, hopefully near you, sometime late summer, early fall. So when will we go to Mars? Well, in the short term, we're going to keep using the space station to do longer and longer journeys on board. Congress has just directed NASA to no longer worry about going to an asteroid, which had been the course that we were following for the past 6 years or 7 years or so, and to actually go back to the moon, and to this time, however, be very focused on planning for Mars exploration when we go back to the moon. So I think at this point, it's a good idea. First of all, other people are going to the moon, and for that reason alone, it's hard to imagine the United States not going back to the moon. If China is sending astronauts to the moon, you can't imagine the United States being focused on getting humans to Mars. We will have to be on the moon as well. And so therefore, for that reason alone, I think we will be heading back to the moon in the short term, no matter what. Also, the Apollo experience is fading. We often say we went to the moon, but we actually did not go to the moon. It was a generation ago that went to the moon. And so we have to sort of get our hands dirty again and learn how to do that properly. But we should focus on Mars when we go back to the moon and not turn this into a giant program that, you know, serves no purpose. And we should otherwise, I think, let private industry do other things on the moon, like space tourism and resource extraction. That's something that NASA should have no business doing. Now, as far as going to Mars, the first targets at Mars might be its moons. They are fascinating places. My favorite is Phobos. It's about the size of Manhattan Island. If there were buildings, you would see them there. Phobos's gravity is 1,700 times less than the Earth's gravity. Deimos's gravity is 2,000 times less than Earth's gravity. If you were to just push yourself off on your legs like this on Phobos, you would rise to about a mile high, slowly, and then slowly fall back down onto Phobos. And then when you land on your feet, it would be no harder than when you pushed yourself off. Okay, it'd be a lot of fun. But you'd have a spectacular view of Mars from Phobos, and going to the moons of Mars would, of course, be a grand rehearsal of going to Mars, and it's sort of the Apollo 8 equivalent, going around the moon first before you sort of land. It's a wise thing to do, and the moons themselves are very exciting places. We don't know what they are. We need to understand them. Okay. A big milestone here in terms of getting humans to Mars itself, NASA organized just this past October the first ever workshop on selecting a landing site for the first human crew on Mars. And so about 50 teams proposed their favorite sites. They're all shown here. There were constraints. We couldn't propose a site farther north than 50 degrees north or south. Polar regions are hard to get to, and also they are too cold for electronics. So my team at NASA Ames and a few others, we selected Noctis Landing, and we've been making the case that that's a great place to go because towards the east, you can see this giant canyon system. It's sort of the mother of all road cuts on Mars. You can see all the rock layers of ancient Mars and look for fossils in these rock layers. So it gives you access to ancient life on Mars. And it's also near the volcanoes, which you see towards the left there. The giant volcanoes on Mars could still be active, not erupting, but just dormant. They could still be warm, cozy, and wet on the inside. And that would be a fantastic place to look for living life on Mars. So that's the place we're suggesting. And of course, I'm biased towards it, but it's really a good place. Speaking of volcanoes, this is my favorite volcano. It's Olympus Mons. It's the tallest mountain in the solar system. Mount Everest is that little black triangle at the bottom. Olympus Mons is shown in profile here. It's a gigantic, gigantic shield volcano, just like Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa in Hawaii, which, by the way, that's why we go to Hawaii. It's for its volcanoes. So this is close to my final slide. Who will this person be? Who will go to Mars? Well, you're looking at a crew size of 5 to 8 people. Should it be a gender mix? Should it be an ethnic mix? Should it be an international mix? Should it be a marital mix? A marital mix meaning husband and wife. So you've got a crew of 7 people, husband and wife, husband and wife, husband and wife, and then the 7th person. Who's the home wrecker? Okay. No. So all of these are actually a good, valid political concerns. I mean, you may want, if you have an international mission, several countries paying for the trip, you may want a crew to be international. But it doesn't necessarily mean that you're optimizing the performance of the crew. It just means that it's serving other purposes to be more representative of humanity. Same thing with gender mix and ethnic mix. It's not necessarily something that is done to optimize the performance of the crew. The point is that these criteria are not real criteria. They are sort of imposed criteria. They are circumstantial criteria. They're political criteria. And they can be perfectly valid and important. So that does not diminish them, but they have little to do directly with how well the crew will perform. Okay, you can imagine a husband and wife crew doing very well. I can easily imagine a husband and wife crew not doing well at all, okay, on a 2.5-year journey to Mars. What we do know is that you're going to need Renaissance people. With a crew of only 5 to 8, and let's say 7, all right, you have a lot more than 7 skills to cover. And so you're going to need each person to be an ace at several trades, not just a jack of all trades, an ace at many trades, okay? Because you don't want amateurs here. You want people who can really fly this thing, can really fix the spacesuit, who can really do surgery, who can really extract a tooth, who can really fix the plumbing. So you want Renaissance people, people who are multiply skilled, including redundancy skills, okay? So you don't want to have just one person who knows how to fly this ship. What if that person dies? Okay, with cross-training. What that means, though, is that you will have seasoned astronauts. No matter how smart you are, it's impossible to be multiply skilled and have a lot of experience in a lot of things when you're still very young. Okay, Yuri Gagarin remains one of the youngest astronauts who ever flew. He was 26 years old. He was a great pilot, but that's all that was needed from him. He didn't need to be also good at biology and plumbing. But for mission to Mars, you need people who will have had time to acquire a lot of expertise. This means that the crew will not be made up of young people. It's sort of another thing that is not just going against what's shown in The Martian, but in most science fiction movies, you see crews of young young crews, and it's unrealistic in the case of a mission to Mars. The average age of a crew to Mars will be probably 55 years old, maybe 60. Okay, now they might have a token young person to make fun of on the trip, but that's really it. It's the famous 10,000 hours. Okay, you're not an expert at something unless you have spent 10,000 hours doing it. You're not a really good surgeon until you've done 10,000 surgeries. You're not a really good pilot until you've flown 10,000 hours. It's not a rule, but it's a rough estimate. The crew qualities, finally, knowledge, number one. Even if you don't get along with that person, if he or she knows how to fly the ship and you're going home, that's what you want from this person. Okay? The crew members have to be healthy, physically and mentally. They have to be really motivated. This is not just being motivated to spend 2.5 years away from home. This is being motivated to the point where you want to spend 10 or 20 years of your life training for a mission to Mars, and you might not go in the end. Okay? So serious motivation here. You want to be very adaptable. Adaptable meaning tolerant of others, tolerant of change, tolerant of stress. The plan will not go as planned, okay? And so things will come up. You have to not mind that. and just be very adaptable. Finally, you want to be altruistic. You have to care for your other crewmates as if they were family. You have to be ultimately unselfish and ready to serve your crewmates and your mission. So that's very important. All right, that's it. Thank you.